Hello, today we are with Miss Jeannie Cho Lee, master, who is in fact the first Asian to be a master of wine. Quite an accomplishment. I wish I could list all of Miss Jeannie Cho Lee's accomplishments, but there are just far too many of them. But being a master of wine, how did that come about, and what started you in the process of wine, please?
I think it was really a genuine love for flavors, and you know, my first love was not wine. It was actually food. And so before I started the Master of Wine program, I spent a year at Cordon Bleu, thinking that I might take the culinary profession more seriously. But I realized the hours, the combination of physical hard labor involved in being in a kitchen, a commercial kitchen, was not something I wanted long term. So wine became the kind of adjunct and accompaniment. And because I perceived it always as part of the table and part of the whole enjoyment and pleasure of eating, it's natural that I developed a curiosity. And as the, you know, as a typical maybe type A personality Asian person, when you have a hobby that becomes time consuming and as well as you know, more interesting than your real job, which at the time was as a journalist, then you study and rack up a few degrees, and I think the Master of Wine was sort of the pinnacle.
Right. Now, just for those that don't know, what exactly is a Master of Wine, and why is it so significant that you are the first Asian, if you like, between inverted commas, to be a Master of Wine?
Well, the Master of Wine title is really conferred from the Institute of Masters of Wine in the UK. They've been around since the 1950s. And they've been notorious within the wine industry as being very exclusive, sort of a club, because the exam itself is so difficult for people to pass. And even if I talk to masters of wine who passed that exam 20, 30 years ago, they still say, even at that time within the trade, it was always difficult to pass. And why is it so difficult? It's a it's a 3-day exam. It consists of lots of grueling tastings, essays, knowledge that goes beyond just memorizing facts and knowing about the world of wine, but really trying to have your own opinions, being able to show examples, to express a mastery of the subject in viticulture, in vinification, which is winemaking, as well as the business of wine. So it's the breadth of information that I think on the academic side turned a lot of people away. And half of the exam, of course, is the practical, which is the tasting. And some people find that very challenging. 36 wines blind, and having to write essays about its origin, its vintage, how it was made, what potential quality of grapes were derived when that wine was produced. And all these little details you get from really just a few minutes in your mouth, and it takes a lot of training, I suppose, to get to that level. And I think it's been daunting for a lot of people. But I think there's a lot of Asians who are now seriously pursuing it. And as far as I know, there are definitely more than a dozen Asian students on the program, so it's great.
Well, to be the first, I must say I'm humbled and obviously very privileged to meet you today. You mentioned Asians, and there's many students coming through the works now. How has the understanding of wine, and how is wine developing as in Asia Pacific?
Yes.
How is it developing?
Well, I think it depends on country, and you know, it's like trying to generalize about Europe. And I know we use these terms to give a macro view of what's happening. Is I think country by country, for example, here in Thailand, I think one of the real instigators of interest in wine has been the local Thai wine industry. You know, the Thai Winery Association being able to brand things as New Latitude wines and creating a group that includes wine tourism, that includes lots of wine tasting, and supporting the F&B in terms of education and supplying on a local level, I think has made a big difference. And I would say the same is true in China, where more than 80% of wine consumed in China is domestic. So it's local wine industry, the people who are based there, who have roots there, who are able to really spread the wine gospel and really try to get people turned on to wine.
Right. Now, you mentioned a few markets there. Now, of course, wine in Asia Pacific has existed for centuries, but it tends to be very much rice wine. How does the wine of Master of Wine, does that recognize such wines, such as sake and soju and plum wine?
That's a very good question, because the way that wine is defined in the European community officially is wine equals alcoholic fermented beverage from freshly gathered grapes. Not rice, not wheat, not barley, not sorghum, you know, which are all the base ingredients for making a lot of our indigenous spirits and wines. So even in the Chinese language of wine, the translation, we call it putaojiu, and that's grape alcohol. So all jiu is actually alcohol, and it doesn't really mean wine made from grapes. So because of the way that it's defined differently in Europe, I think it's one of the basic criteria of kind of misunderstanding. Because if you look at grape-based wine, our history of consuming, selling, and enjoying only pure grape-based wine is actually very short. So in the European definition of enjoyment of Western wine, then it's very short. Now, I think you're justified in adding soju, baijiu, which is the white spirits, or sake, or many rice fermented beverages, which, you know, have actually had a very long following. I think that is an integral part of our dining culture, and it still fits in. One of the advantages that wine really has is the fact that it's lower in alcohol than most of these grain-based spirits. So there's the balance of the health benefit, moderate amounts of alcohol with lower alcohol levels. You know, wine is mostly below 15%. That, you know, allows you to enjoy the flavors, enjoy the beverage, but at the same time not have the severe alcohol health risks and other, you know, disadvantages associated with that. So even in places throughout the Far East, whether it's Japan or China or Korea, in that whole area, I think on a more government level, people have been encouraging the general public to consume wine rather than local spirits for health reasons. And then there's also the added studies that have you know, surfaced over the last 20 years about the benefits of red wine and the role of tannins and phenolics as an antioxidant. So you combine all of those elements and you can see why wine is so popular.
Right. And as you mentioned earlier as well, countries, new latitude lines, such as the one we're in at the moment, Thailand. What do these countries need to do to reach the levels of even the new world wines of Australia and Chile? What do countries such as Thailand and other countries in Asia Pacific need to do to be able to reach those type of levels?
Well, I think the most important thing about any product is really the site that it comes from, and for tropical climates like Thailand, or, you know, there's lots of plantations in India, in the southern part as well, where these are out of the normal latitude, and so you already have a disadvantage of not being able to keep that vine dormant. So during the period in typical wine growing regions, you have a dormant period where that vine is able to rest, build up its carbs, and then get ready to give its maximum flavor-wise, as well as its profile and structure to the one harvest. But here we have two in Thailand. And so even if you prune and you try to cut all the first harvest off and concentrate really on the second, it's still not going to be as giving as the same effort made in a climate where vines are meant to be concentrated and small. So it's naturally, we're working with the climate. But having said that, I think that with the higher altitude, so you can plant at much higher altitude up in a mountain, and you get cooler temperatures, but even then you're still dealing with no winters. No opportunity for the vines to rest as they should if they want to produce quality wine. So how can we make wines that are going to compete with Australia? I think for certain styles it's possible. For example, I think white wines, there's a great possibility of making great wines with good acidity, crisp, fresh, you know, uncomplicated, easy to enjoy, and great with Thai food. Those style of white wines, red wines are always going to be more difficult because a lot of the flavor depends on the maturity and the flavor concentration in the skins of those grapes. And the skins absolutely develop much better. They're given time to rest. And so there's a disadvantage already there. I think we have the potential of making in Thailand here very good sparkling wines as well. So there are certain styles and categories where I think it can be world class, but it's a nascent industry, just starting. So I think, you know, you talk to anybody in Europe and they'll tell you, oh yes, it's easy to make great wines. It's just the first 200 years that are hard. so we have 100 and about 40 more to go.
So be patient. Be patient is the word. We will get there. Just be patient. I wanted to ask you, you mentioned there Asian food, and this is the big thing, isn't it? Because obviously when you talk about French wines, especially some of the Bordeaux, you think of rich food, you think of foie gras, you think of this, that, the other.
Yes.
Here in Asia, the food is a little bit different in terms of the weight, I'd say, of the food and the richness.
Yes.
How does somebody choose a wine that goes suitably well with the different Asia-Pacific cuisines?
Yes. You know, I think, again, it's incredibly hard to generalize because Thai food is so different from Cantonese food, and it's so different from Japanese sushi or kaiseki or, you know, Korean type of garlic and chilies, and it's very different from Northern Chinese. But having said that, one of the overarching themes after spending 2.5 years writing my first book about Asian food and wine pairing is that the wine suited for most Asian tables really require great acidity, a freshness value, which goes well whether you're dealing with very light, elegant, textured dishes like sashimi. In Japan, you still need freshness and acidity because you don't want anything heavy and high tannin. And so if you deal with something very spicy, like in Thailand, you're talking about, you know, very spicy small chili peppers, then again, you need acidity to be able to really stand up to some of those chili spices and also cleanse your palate. Because, you know, the flavors in Thailand are so intense. They're not heavy, but they're very intense. And to have a wine that has the correct amount of acidity to counteract that, to balance that, to stand up to it, is, again, comes back to acidity. And so if I were to suggest a style of wine that suits most Asian meals, I would say red or white, it doesn't matter. It really depends on whether you're having meat-based, mostly meat-based, you know, dishes on your table, or it's mostly vegetarian perhaps. So if it's lighter, then opt with a very fresh, crisp white wine. And if it's red, again, still look for acidity and freshness in the red wine, because there will be difficulty trying to pair a very tannic, oaky, high alcohol, really full-bodied monster with a lot of the dishes that we enjoy.
Right. Now, you must be an amazing lady to go shopping for wine for, because you know what the bottles are all about. But for most of the average person, they walk into an off-license, if you like, here, a supermarket,
yes,
and they're faced with 100, 200, 300, 400 bottles of different wine.
Yes.
Could you tell us, how do you choose a good wine? How important, for example, is if you choose something that's been sold by a négociant, mm-hmm, compared to being sold directly by the château? Is that important?
Yes.
What,
yes,
things should they look for on the label? How important is the appellation contrôlée? What should they look for when they're buying a wine?
Well, I think the very beginning really starts with what occasion is it for, and, you know, to consider really your audience and the people who are going to enjoy it and appreciate it. If you're doing a barbecue for 100 people, I would not choose a very serious wine because it's not the occasion to stand around having, you know, very casual food, and the goal of the wine is to help you socialize. rather than it be a wine-focused meal. So if it's that's the first question I would ask myself about the occasion. Second, I would really try to see if the person who's buying the wine has an understanding of the different countries and regions and styles. And everybody starts out at a different level, as you said. And a lot of people probably have heard of France, French wines, probably have heard of Bordeaux, possibly. And they have a vague idea, perhaps, of Californian or Australian wines. And, to look at a label and to say, oh, I am familiar with this appellation and not that one, is one of the steps. I would say that there are sort of three basic levels of trying to gear people toward choosing wine or selecting wine comfortably. A very easy way, and this is for all beginner wine courses, is to go by grape variety. To say, okay, if you like Cabernet, which is a full-bodied red with deep color, strong tannins, then perhaps you might want to go to Bordeaux. If you want something that has more restraint and isn't too fruity and big and powerful. But on the other hand, if you like and appreciate very ripe, sometimes even jammy, very friendly fruit without tannins that are so dry or astringent, then you might want to gravitate towards Cabernets from Australia or California or other parts of the New World, Chile, for example. And then the other, after grape variety, so you decide how familiar you are. Maybe Chardonnay, that it's a medium to full-bodied white with plenty of fruity flavors. But perhaps you've heard of Sauvignon Blanc, where it's much more herbaceous. And it has crisper acidity and is not as big or generous, but it has this wonderful, focused, herbaceous flavors. So it depends on how familiar you are in terms of how you would start. But once you get over the grape variety phase, the next phase is the regions and the places. Like you said, how important is Appellation Contrôlée in France? What does it mean to have a label that says Bordeaux? And In a region as big as Bordeaux, where there are over 10,000 producers, I would say it means very little. If it's an appellation, let's say, called Central Otago, let's say, Northern Rhone, Hermitage in Rhone, it means a lot, because the region is very small. And so there's a consistency and the ability to give a level of advice that's more accurate than something as generic as red Bordeaux, which is huge. So I think that's the next step, is really being familiar with and understanding the styles from the different regions and how much the Appellation Contrôlée needs. And the third then comes to producers. How familiar are you with a domain, Maison Camuset in Burgundy? What does that mean to you versus a domain like Louis Jadot or Bouchard? And these are négociants, which are much larger in size, whereas Comte de Vogüé or Domaine du Jacques or Maison Camuset, these are very small, I would say, boutique-style domains, and they don't produce the volume as some of the larger négociants. So there, it's wine knowledge and learning is a kind of a step-by-step process. And it's hard to direct people unless you have a good idea of where they're coming from. Are they in the grape variety phase, or the appellation and the regional phase, or are they at a level where they can discuss vintage and producer names in a specific region? And that means going really deep. So to make it very simple, however, if people have none of those things, I usually say that, and I just mentioned how important acidity is, look for the origin and think on a map where it might be. So if you're looking at, for example, a wine from Australia and New Zealand, two Chardonnays, one from Australia, one from New Zealand. The one from New Zealand, being cooler, right, it's further south in the southern hemisphere, is going to have higher acidity, more fresher notes, not as tropical and fruity in the ripe tropical mango or banana or pineapple flavors as a same wine from Australia, from a warmer region. So the geographical differences, and you know, we were talking earlier about how important the climate and the site is one indicator as to the style that you're going to get. So without knowing anything, if you know where the wine is from, that's one way to choose.
Very interesting indeed. And to be honest with you, Miss Jeannie Cho Lee, I could spend hours talking to you, but unfortunately, I don't think whether our viewers will be able to spend so much time on this particular video. My final question for you today, because we are running out of time, unfortunately, is champagne. It's just for celebration. Celebrate the fact that you're here at the World Gourmet Festival. What are your top three, your favorite three champagnes? If you could go to a desert island and only take three champagnes, which would they be?
Well, you know, first, I have to say, I'm friends with a lot of champagne producers. So whatever three I choose, the other hundreds are going to hate me. So it's a very, very tough choice. I would say that one of them would have to be Krug Champagne. It's always been one of my favorites, and especially a vintage like the 1996, which is just opening up right now. I think it's exceptional, beautiful. I love the delicacy of Salon Champagne. And you're saying money's no object, right?
So. Well, I'm not paying, so it's on video. So.
I'm assuming. Because I could think of lots of other non-prestige cuvées that are wonderful too, but I'm thinking of the very top. So Salon would be my second choice. And my third one would be a small grower champagne called Aigle Ourlier. And he just makes such detailed lacy, I call it very fine and lacy champagne, that I enjoy very often. So.
Well, Ms. Jeannie Cho Lee, I can't argue with that. And I do apologize to all those producers that Ms. Cho Lee was not able to mention, although she did say she loves you all.
Yes.
As I say, I'm honored to meet you today, and thank you very much indeed for your time. Thank you very much, Ms. Cho Lee.
Thanks.